kill. The double talk is past surreal. The word of God is now the word of hate. War is peace and freedom is the police state. Can't you see the writing on the wall? Democracy lays trampled on the floor. You better believe that, hell yeah, I'm confused for sure. What I thought was the new millennium is 1984. Mr. Orwell from the grave, adding fresh ink to the page as the young president declares an endless war.
This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman, as we turn now to investigative journalist Craig Unger in our in Washington, D.C., here with Democracy Now! He's author of the new book, The Fall of the House of Bush, the untold story of how a band of true believers seized the executive branch, started the Iraq War, and still imperils America's future. The book examines how neoconservatives secretly forged an alliance with the Christian right during the Bush presidency and helped make the case for war in Iraq. Craig Unger is the contributing editor at Vanity Fair, also author of the book House of Bush, House of Saud. Craig, welcome to Democracy Now!
Thanks for having me, Amy.
Why don't you start off by laying out the thesis of this book?
Well, I think when most people look at the Middle East conflict today, they frame it in terms of Islam versus the West. I want to try looking at a new paradigm, and that is the battle, that is, I want to examine fundamentalisms, and by that I mean not just Islamic fundamentalism, but Christian and Jewish fundamentalism as well. And I really throw in neoconservatism as sort of a secular form of fundamentalism, which are in conflict with a modern post-Enlightenment world. And I think that's a larger conflict that has gotten us into trouble today in the Middle East.
Talk about President Bush, President George W. Bush's relationship with George H.W. Bush, a central theme that runs through the fall of the House of Bush.
Right. Well, you may have seen there have been a raft of stories recently that they have a very congenial relationship. Last summer, the New York Times had them playing horseshoes out in Kennebunkport, Maine. And on the surface, I think that's the case. I interviewed Bob Strauss, for example, who had been chairman of the National Democratic Party. He was a friend of Bush Sr.'s and had been ambassador to Moscow when the elder George Bush was president. And he said that when he had dinner with the two men, they would just be gossiping, talking about, oh, how's Susie doing in Midland, Texas, and so on. But under the surface, I think there's a real very deep conflict that has affected millions of lives, cost hundreds of billions of dollars, and they represent almost polar opposite points of view. I call the first conflict, first chapter in my book, Oedipus Tex. And if you look at the current Bush administration, you realize he's put together an administration consisting of some of his father's worst enemies. For example, his father was a very congenial man, had very few bitter enemies, but one of them was certainly Donald Rumsfeld. In addition, his father had very little, was not terribly fond of the Christian right, and at one point he called them the extra chromosome crowd, a remark for which he had to apologize. And finally, his father had been doing battle with the neoconservatives as early as 1976. If you go back to that period, Bush Sr. was then head of the CIA. And you see the young neocons had put together what was known as Team B. And they began to challenge the CIA's intelligence on the Cold War. This was the era of detente. They were saying the CIA was a bunch of liberals who were being soft on the Soviet Union. And they tried to they began to politicize intelligence and distort it and come up with a much tougher line. And in there, I think you see a lot of the foreshadowing of the events we're going through today.
As we talk about how President Bush and Vice President Cheney made the case for war in Iraq, I want to turn to comments made by Dick Cheney in September of 1992. At the time, he was President George H.W. Bush's Secretary of Defense. During an address at the Economic Club of Detroit, Cheney was asked why the United States didn't bury Saddam Hussein during the Gulf War. This is how he responded close to 15 years ago.
At the end of the war in the Gulf, when we made the decision to stop, we did so because we had achieved our military objectives. That is, when we decided to halt military operations. And those objectives were twofold: to liberate Kuwait, and secondly, to strip Saddam Hussein of his offensive military capability, of his capacity to threaten his neighbors. And we'd done that. There's no doubt in my mind but what we could have gone on to Baghdad and taken Baghdad, occupied the whole country. We had the 101st Airborne up on the Euphrates River Valley, about halfway between Kuwait and Baghdad. And I don't think from a military perspective that it would have been an impossible task. Clearly it wouldn't, given the forces that we had there. But we made a very conscious decision not to proceed for several reasons, in part because as soon as you go to Baghdad to get Saddam Hussein, you have to recognize that you're undertaking a fairly complex operation. It's not the kind of situation where we could have pulled up in front of the presidential palace in Baghdad and said, come on, Saddam, you're going to the slammer. We would have had to run him to ground. A lot of places he could have gone to hide out or to resist. It would have required the extensive military forces to achieve that. But let's assume for the moment that we would have been able to do it. We've got Saddam now, and maybe we put him down there in Miami with Noriega. Then the question comes, putting a government in place of the one you've just gotten rid of. You can't just sort of turn around and walk away. You've now accepted the responsibility for what happens in Iraq. What kind of government do you want us to create in place of the old Saddam Hussein government? You want a Sunni government or a Shia government? Or maybe it ought to be a Kurdish government? Or maybe one based on the Ba'ath Party? Or maybe some combination of all of those? How long is that government likely to survive without U.S. military forces there to keep it propped up? If you get into the business of committing U.S. forces on the ground in Iraq to occupy the place, my guess is I'd probably still have people there today instead of having been able to bring them home. We would have been in a situation once we went into Baghdad where we would have engaged in the kind of street-by-street, house-to-house fighting in an urban setting that would have been dramatically different from what we were able to do in the Gulf, in Kuwait, in the desert, where our precision-guided munitions and our long-range artillery and tanks were so devastating against those Iraqi forces. You would have been fighting in a build-up urban area, large civilian population, and much heavier prospects for casualties. You would have found as well, I think, probably the disintegration of the Arab coalition that signed on to support us in our efforts to eject the Iraqis from Kuwait, but never signed on for the proposition that the United States would become some kind of quasi-permanent occupier of a major Middle Eastern nation. And the final point with respect to casualties, everybody, of course, was tremendously impressed with the fact that we were able to prevail at such a low cost, given the predictions with respect to casualties in major modern warfare. But for the 146 Americans who were killed in action, and for their families, it was not a cheap or a low-cost conflict. The bottom line question for me was, how many additional American lives is Saddam Hussein worth? The answer, not very damn many. I think the president got it right both times, both when he decided to use military force to defeat Saddam Hussein's aggression, but also when he made what I think was a very wise decision to stop military operations when we did.
That was Dick Cheney speaking in September of 1992 at the Economic Club of Detroit. Our guest is investigative journalist Craig Unger.